Hello, and welcome to the Dental Learning Center. I'm your hostess, Dr. Marie Huggy. I'd like to begin by thanking our sponsor, the Banana Creme Supreme Pie Company, for supplying us with some of their great pie. With us today is the eminent professor of dentistry, Dr. Grovelier.
That's pronounced Grovelier. Grovelier is the name. Thank you, Marie.
Doctor, today we wanted to look at a partial denture design with some interesting mechanical characteristics. I understand you're an expert in such matters.
Oh, quite.
Dr. G, if I may, here is the arch in question. Our examination of the patient includes the following items. The periodontal condition of the remaining maxillary teeth is excellent. The patient has limited financial means, there are no interferences such as frenal attachments or bony undercuts, and the patient is not aesthetic conscious.
As one can plainly see, Marie, the arch form is a Kennedy class 1 modification 1 arch. That does not mean, however, that the restoration will be such. This arch may be restored also as a Kennedy class 2 modification 1, or as a Kennedy class 4 arch.
How does one decide?
By examining the chief complaint and evaluating teeth in the lower arch.
What about fixed restorations?
The span is quite extensive. Ante's rule probably would be violated with conventional fixed bridge work.
What about implant-supported restoration?
Marie, semi-precision attachments, implants, fixed or a combination could be used here, but the cost is prohibitive for this patient.
Okay, so we make a plastic partial?
Well, that's an option in an aesthetic emergency, but I would suggest a cast-clasped retained partial. The beauty in part is the relatively non-invasive nature of the treatment, and cost-effective. Just because Dr. Know-It-All hates partial dentures doesn't rule it out. If the patient later acquires the means and desire for more extensive treatment, then that is something I would consider.
Is a complete denture an option?
Well, certainly you could present that option to the patient. Ultimately, the patient must decide, with the informed wisdom of the care provider to guide them.
Dr. G, normally the first thing is to do a history and physical examination. We can determine that the patient successfully wore a partial once before.
Very important, Marie. I would ask the patient to bring the partial to the examination appointment. I would like to see the components, especially the major connector.
Yes, Dr. G, any dental history can be of critical importance. Do we need to survey this cast? It looks pretty straightforward.
Marie, each case should be considered on its own merits. But making a partial without surveying the cast is like eating this pie without the whipped cream, and that goes for accurately mounted diagnostic casts as well.
All right, doctor, we surveyed this cast and have located the guide planes and areas of axial recontouring. We also discovered that there are no areas of potential interference to the path of insertion. Retention is bilaterally opposed and is approximately 0.02 inches in the cervical one-third of the tooth. The axial height of contour may be lowered to the middle one-third by judicious removal of tooth structure.
Marie, what do the lower teeth look like?
Missing all the molars. Currently, he has no lower partial and does not desire one. The patient's chief complaint is that he would like to have teeth in the front, and does not have difficulty with mastication.
Capital Marie. That really simplifies the approach. So initially we would like to determine how the partial denture is to be supported. Marie, the answer to this question is really the key. Should we delay this part, and keep your viewers in suspense?
I hardly think so. Could someone please bring the good doctor another pie? You were provided a fork and napkin with that, weren't you?
Oh yes, quite. Now where were we?
We first need to determine the guide planes. There are four potential guiding surfaces we could use. Should they be long or short?
Since we're talking about a Kennedy Class 4 approach, we could use long. Although the condition of the alveolar ridge is considered, the size of the span requires a lot of support from the ridge. This is an example of an anterior extension base partial, and the guide planes on the mesial of premolars should be short. Distal guide planes probably are not needed, but would further limit the path of dislodgement, and add bulk to the origin of any circumferential clasp engaging the mesial undercut of the terminal tooth. The proximal plates may be relieved at the framework try-in to limit binding in function.
And what about the wrist seats, Doctor?
I was afraid you would ask that question, Marie. For the Class 4 anterior extension base partial denture, there should only be one axis of rotation, and some opportunity for indirect retention. It's very much like the distal extension partial, with the position of the components reversed. Also, Marie, and this is just a suggestion, I would recommend placing the primary rest seats in the form of adjacent occlusal, or double occlusal rest seats as seen in the diagram. I would also place occlusal rest seats on the distal, as shown, to provide indirect retention. The axis of rotation of the partial in function will be through the rests, closest to the edentulous space.
Let's draw that for the viewer. That's an important factor, is it not?
Quite so. Placing the clasp tip on the edentulous side means the clasp will disengage from the tooth when the patient bites. Not only that, but the clasp tip engages when off-axis dislodging forces are placed on the partial, and thus supplements the indirect retainer. Probably the first clasp to be considered would be the I-bar placed on the mesial of the premolars with 0.01 inch undercut.
Couldn't we get more retention by using 0.02 inch undercut?
Well, one could, but it's generally recommended to clasp more teeth than to use more than the recommended amount with a given clasp. Reciprocation is provided by the vertical minor connector and proximal plate of the clasp assembly.
Yes, I can see that the clasp assembly encircles the tooth by greater than 180 degrees.
Bravo, Marie.
Let's talk about the base and base retainer.
This is another meaningful use of the accurately mounted cast. For the anterior extension base with sufficient interarch spacing, ladder or mesh retained acrylic may be used. Often, some reshaping of the lower incisors may be needed in the case of supra-eruption. However, if the ridge is firm and realigning is not anticipated, or there is limited interarch space, beaded metal may be employed.
Okay, well, what about the major connector?
The lack of support from the teeth normally would call for a palatal plate major connector as the first consideration. We could maintain the posterior border at the first molar area. Since vertical support is basically of a quadrant type, an AP strap could be used. I would also give serious consideration to the design of the previous partial, which the patient found acceptable. Really, a fairly rigid U-shaped major connector could also be employed.
Okay, Dr. Grovelier, what if the patient wanted more teeth to chew with? How would that affect our design?
Well, that's an interesting case in mechanics. The primary difference would be clasping options and placement of the rests. Let's look at the above diagram. At the point of rotation, displacement travels through a minimum. Clasp tips engaging the tooth from the edentulous side up to and including the of the point of rotation will not exert torque like clasp tips approaching from the side away from the edentulous area.
Yes, Doctor, I think I understand. We want our class 1 or 2 partial with a larger anterior modification space to have only one axis of rotation, and engage the undercut as closely as possible to the point of rotation.
Yes, Marie. You know that sometimes we have to make informed compromises to carry out these things. A double occlusal rest really has two axes of rotation, but located very close together. The clasp tips of the cast round circumferential clasps or wrought wire are as close to the respective points of rotation as possible. Here all four guide planes and proximal plates are short, with relief as necessary.
Dr. Grovelier, when should we select cast round or wrought wire?
Wrought wire is selected when 0.02 inch undercut is present, and when there is adequate space to solder a wire. One may consider the cast round to have better flexural characteristics than the cast half round, and may be used when there is insufficient undercut or space for wrought wire.
Well, friends of the Dental Learning Center, thank you for joining me and Dr. Grovelier.
Okay people. It's a wrap.
Frankie, wow! That guy can really put away the pie.